Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions. And at question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I remind the Chamber that my wife is a serving police officer in Police Scotland? And let me be clear, the vast majority of Scotland's frontline police officers do a fantastic job under incredible pressures. But a new report to the Scottish Police Authority raises a number of serious concerns about systemic issues throughout Police Scotland. The Independent Review found, and I quote, first-hand instances of racism, sexism and homophobia. In response, the Chief Constable of Police Scotland, Sir Ian Livingston, has said this today. It is right for me as Chief Constable to clearly state that institutional racism, sexism, misogyny and discrimination exist. He continued, Police Scotland is institutionally discriminatory and racist. Can I ask the First Minister for his response to the Chief Constable's statement?
First Minister.
Can I thank Douglas Ross for raising this issue? Can I first and foremost commend Sir Ian Livingston, the Chief Constable of Police Scotland, for acknowledging institutional racism and indeed misogyny and other discriminatory behaviours within Police Scotland. That is the first step that is required in order to then dismantle those institutional and structural barriers that exist. Douglas Ross was right to put the emphasis on the fact that, of course, this is not an inference on individual police officers who we know put themselves in harm's way to protect us day in and day out. But there is no doubt that institutional racism exists in our society. And I want to take a moment just to say that, as a person of colour, the statement from the Chief Constable is monumental, historic. I remember raising issues around racism in the police force, Strathclyde Police as it was, back then, when I was stopped and searched over a dozen times as a young boy, whether it was in my car or walking with my friends in the street or in airports at the time. And so the acknowledgement from the Chief Constable is very welcome indeed. I hope it also serves as a reminder to all of us that in whatever organisation we belong to, we have a responsibility to also question whether or not the organisations that we lead, certainly this is the case for me and the organisation that I lead, that we examine and reflect on whether we are doing enough to dismantle those barriers, not just of institutional racism, but structural discrimination that exists for many people with a disability or because of the sexual orientation, because they are women, so on and so forth. So I do welcome the statement from the Chief Constable. As the Chief Constable himself has said, having now made that acknowledgement, it's so, so important we now see action in terms of what can be done to dismantle those barriers. And again, I just end my answer to that particular question by saying that I take my responsibility seriously as First Minister, and I rededicate myself to do everything I can to dismantle those barriers of institutional racism, misogyny, bigotry and discrimination where they exist here in the Scottish Government, and what I can do right across society in that regard.
Douglas Ross.
The Chief Constable also said this today. When an organisation doesn't have all the necessary policies, processes, practices and systems in place to ensure it doesn't happen, it is an institutional matter. The SPA report also found, and I quote, significant concerns about the absence of effective performance management systems during the first decade of Police Scotland's existence. So the problem here is wider. It is systemic. It starts far away from the front line with the management and the leadership. Does the First Minister agree? And given that he has just rededicated himself to tackling this issue, what urgent action will his government take in response to the SPA report and the Chief Constable's statement today?
First Minister.
Of course, those in management and leadership positions absolutely have to bear responsibility, particularly where it is organisations that we lead. It is our responsibility to ensure that we examine the evidence, we collate the data, and we come to the conclusion around those structural barriers that exist. That is true for me as First Minister. I'm certain Douglas Ross will be reflecting on the organisation, the political party that he leads as well. So there is an important point for those that are in management or indeed leadership. There is one phrase that is often used by Anas Sarwar. For all our disagreements, there's one phrase that I've always found that he has used that I think captures the issue very well, and that is that this is a fight for us all. I think that's absolutely right. I think although management and leadership absolutely have a role to play, that all of us have a role to play in our organisations in order to confront those barriers, reflect on what more we can do to undermine them. I'm committed to working with Police Scotland, but above and beyond that, I want to make sure that all of those organisations that are particularly within the public sector, I want to make sure that we are collecting the data, that we have a view on those structural barriers that exist, and then, of course, work with senior management and leadership right across, particularly the public sector, but I'd also challenge the private sector in this regard too, as I say, to dismantle those barriers that we know have existed and do exist right across our society.
Douglas Ross.
The SPA review also found outright fear among officers about bringing forward complaints. The report notes at paragraph 5.8, we heard of people being punished for raising issues or concerns. That is so clearly unacceptable, that police officers who are raising these concerns internally were being punished. We must surely all agree that officers should be able to raise legitimate concerns without suffering any consequences. My party has raised these officers' concerns about the broken police complaint system for some time. It is clearly not fit for purpose. So given the severity of this report to the police authority and the Chief Constable's statement, will the First Minister vow to change the current complaint system and the process within the force that has clearly in the past and continues to let down frontline officers who are raising legitimate concerns?
First Minister.
I think it's a very fair point from Douglas Ross. We are already, of course, taking forward work from the Dame Elise Angelini review and indeed various HMICS reports in this regard. So if there is more work we can do, I absolutely commit to responding to Douglas Ross's challenge and the challenge that others have raised to look at the complaints process. Now, process is one thing. It is, of course, important, so important that we look at having the correct process. But culture, I would say, is equally, if not sometimes even more important. And that's why I think the Chief Constable's statement was so monumental, because what it's demonstrating from the very, very top of the organisation, that culture simply is not acceptable. And of course, that is important, that permeates down right through the ranks. But again, I go back to the point that Douglas Ross makes. Of course, what more we can do in terms of the process in place, I will absolutely look and seek to do. We are, as I say, taking forward the recommendations of the Dame Elise Angelini review and various HMICS reports in this regard. But I do welcome the statement from the Chief Constable. It's more than just process, process being important, of course, but of course culture is vital too.
Douglas Ross.
The Dame Angelini report published in 2020, 3 years on, officers are still commenting about a system that is broken. We have been raising this in this chamber for some time, and I think this further report to the SPA and the Chief Constable's statement today makes that an absolutely crucial issue that must be dealt with the utmost urgency. The SPA report also found that frontline pressures have left officers without the time to take part in vital training exercise. It found officers didn't feel that they had time to deal with legitimate complaints and grievances because they were so stretched with their responsibility to maintain public order. The SPA report found, and I quote, "The greatest challenge we heard and observed to driving cultural change within the service was the pressures on frontline resourcing." Unison have said that there is a £74 million shortfall in the policing budget. Now, absolutely none of that excuses discrimination, but it is a serious problem limiting Police Scotland's ability to change its culture and leaving thousands of first-class officers without the resources they need to do their job. So does the First Minister accept that Scotland's police officers are being asked to do too much with too little?
First Minister.
I don't agree with that characterisation, and can I emphasise and re-emphasise a point that Douglas Ross just made? Of course, funding, and Douglas Ross is absolutely within his rights to question us in relation to our funding. That can never be an excuse for institutional racism, institutional misogyny, institutional discrimination, wherever it exists. And that is a point, in fairness, Douglas Ross himself has made, but I just want to re-emphasise. In terms of the funding that we provide for Police Scotland, despite UK government austerity over the years, we've increased police funding year on year since 2016. We've invested more than £11.6 billion in policing since the creation of Police Scotland in 2013. In terms of police officer numbers, of course, these are matters operational for the Chief Constable, but the latest data, the latest comparable data that we have shows that there's 30 police officers per 10,000 in Scotland. It compares favourably to 24 officers per 10,000 in other parts of the UK, in England and in Wales. In terms of what more we can do to reduce the burden on police officers, which again is a very fair and legitimate point for Douglas Ross to raise, we're doing a fair bit of work in relation to the calls of the call-outs in terms of mental health that police officers often have to attend, which we know takes up a significant amount of their time, and happy to write to Douglas Ross with detail of that work that we are progressing. In terms of going back to the crux of the questions that Douglas Ross is asking, we have been working alongside policing partners to deliver Dame Alicia Angelini's recommendations. To date, 58 of those recommendations have been delivered. And given the urgency of this issue, the government will introduce later this year the Police Complaints and Misconduct Handling Bill to deliver on those recommendations. But I go back to the central point that I think everybody will agree with. It is so important that the acknowledgement of institutional racism and other discriminatory behaviours is recognised. What is really important is to then work together to ensure that we dismantle those barriers. I'm certainly committed to doing that. I've got no doubt the Chief Constable is, and I'm certain whoever succeeds him in his role will also look to do that too.
Thank you. Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
President Officer, myself, the First Minister and many others have been campaigning on the issue of racism, prejudice and hate for many, many years, and I don't think we can downplay the significance of the bold statement from the Chief Constable today. But I think it's important to emphasise there is not a single organisation or institution that is immune to prejudice. So what we must see is not just the words, although they are important, but it must inspire action. And as the First Minister has said, that is a responsibility for each and every single one of us. Presiding Officer, there is a culture of secrecy and cover-up at the heart of this dysfunctional and incompetent SNP government. The dodgy deal with Liberty Steel, the ferry fiasco, the symbolic deposit return scheme, even heartbreaking tragedies at the Queen Elizabeth, all shrouded in secrecy. But incompetence has consequences, whether it's hidden from view or not. Freedom of information laws are one of the last defences against SNP cover-up, but ministers are riding roughshod over these laws. But new data we are publishing today shows the number of FOI requests the Scottish Government has passed on to ministers for approval has risen fivefold. And once a case goes to ministers to sign off or to cover up, waiting times double, with one in every six FOI breaching legally binding response times. So can I ask the First Minister, what's he got to hide?
First Minister.
There is nothing to hide, and it is a sign of, I think, increasing desperation that Anna Sarwar is relying on insinuation, relying on trying to throw as much mud as he possibly can to hope that things stick. Taking that scattergun approach, but actually, of course, this government has a very good record when it comes to responding to freedom of information. We are one of the governments that has the most ambitious targets on these islands when it comes to, of course, responding to FOI legislation. Yes, there have undoubtedly been challenges. I was questioned on this issue at the last convener's group committee meeting yesterday. I responded by saying I'm more than happy to review and to look at, to investigate what further the Scottish Government can do to ensure that we are the most transparent government on these islands. That is what we will seek to do.
Thank you,
and what
members.
I would say to Anna Sarwar, there is, of course, legitimately a reason why ministers may have to sign off on freedom of information requests. I've made it very clear to our cabinet secretaries, to ministers, that when those approvals come up, that they should be, of course, signed off with urgency and with pace. And what I would say, Anna Sauer, of course, mentioned Ferguson Shipyard. In relation to transparency, of course, the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary, came at the earliest opportunity. As soon as that written authority was provided, he came at the first opportunity, took questions, made sure he answered those questions. That presiding officer is not hiding away. That is transparency in action.
Anna Sauer.
Thank you. Presiding officer, he says he's transparent. Transparently hopeless is what people will see right across the country. Because what we pointed to was facts. And what he should do is listen to his own information commissioner. Because, presiding officer, the SNP despise transparency. At every turn, they cover up failure and instead of confronting it. No answers on what is going to happen to their shambolic deposit return scheme. No answers on the ferry fiasco, despite years of delays and millions of pounds overspent. No answers for families bereaved by the scandal at the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital and bullying investigations kept secret. Now, I asked the last First Minister to share the outcome of Fergus Ewing's bullying investigation, and she said it was legally impossible. But Hamza Yousaf has now suggested he's had a change of heart. Why? Because the politician in question has the audacity to question the SNP leadership. So can I ask the first? So can the First Minister tell me, does he believe in transparency every day, or just when he desperately needs it to try and intimidate his critics?
First Minister.
Desperate, desperate stuff, presiding officer. As I said, when Anna Sauer, somebody who has lots of style but no substance, comes to this chamber and demands we take action. When he demands we take action,
members,
but has no facts to back it up, that's when you know how desperate Anna Sauer really, really is, presiding officer. So let me give him some of the facts that were missing, of course, from his question. Here are some of the facts. Scotland has been a member of the Open Government Partnership since 2016. In 2022, last year, we handled more than 4,500 Freedom of Information requests, and 86%, more than 8 out of 10 of those responses came within 20 working days. We want to do more. I think we should try to see if we can improve that rate of response where we can. And on DRS, which is incredible, it now seems that Anna Sauer is taking the side of the Cabinet's man in Scotland. He is taking the side of the party that is determined to undermine devolution. Anna Sauer, so desperate to attack the SNP, he's siding with the party that opposed the creation of the Scottish Parliament in the first place, presiding officer. And when it comes to the question he asked in relation to ministerial complaints, my view has not changed from my predecessor. She was absolutely right. We have an obligation in government to, of course, ensure we take legal advice where appropriate and to make sure that we adhere to that legal advice when it comes to any issue, including complaints around former ministers. So I will continue to make sure I take that responsible approach, but of course I will also continue to make sure we do everything we can as a government to be as open and transparent as we possibly can.
Anna Sauer.
Presiding officer, we now have a first, a no-style and no-substance First Minister and leader of the SNP. And actually, we're taking the side of Scottish businesses and Scottish jobs, and perhaps he should listen to the consequences that he's imposing on people.
Mr. Sauer, sorry. I mean, I can hardly hear here. Those who are gathered here to witness this session in action, I'm sure they would like to hear too. So let's just keep the noise down, shall we, while members are on their feet. Mr. Sauer.
It's OK, Presiding Officer. The strategy is going really well. Just keep doing what you're doing. It's working really well for you. The SNP are taking Scots for a ride, and we don't even get the luxury of enjoying the camper van. FOI laws are flouted, dissent is suppressed, and problems are swept under the carpet. This is a dysfunctional, incompetent and sleaze-ridden government failing on the basics. And this has consequences. An NHS at breaking point and a cost of living crisis spiralling out of control. A party in chaos distracted from the day job. Finances under police investigation, a former council leader under police investigation, the last chief executive arrested, the last treasurer arrested, offices raided and police tents in gardens. So I have two questions for the First Minister. He says he is transparent. So can he tell us how many police investigations are ongoing into the activities of his party and his government? And secondly, when will he finally end the rotten culture of secrecy and incompetence at the heart of this SNP government?
First Minister.
You know, I tend to think it's best for politicians to leave these verdicts to the people of Scotland. Yeah. And of course, they have chosen the SNP time and time and time again to leave this Scottish government. And I saw Anna Sawar celebrating polls that once again put the Labour Party in second place, celebrating being a loser. That sums up Anna Sawar and the Scottish Labour Party pretty well, presiding officer. Anna Sawar said when it came to DRS, he is on the side of business. Can I remind him that many people in business, many of our business organisations, want the DRS progress? None less, of course, than AG Barr, the producers of Scotland's national drink, Iron Brew, Coca-Cola. Many organisations, many business organisations, want, of course, the DRS to go ahead because, of course, they see the value in protecting our environment, and that's what DRS will do. But incredibly, just to take a pop at the SNP, Anna Sawar sides with the Tories. It's not the only place, presiding officer, where he sided with the Tories, because if you want to talk about business, we know one of the biggest shocks to the economy has been because of that hard Brexit that has been imposed upon us by the Conservative government. And of course, Keir Starmer's Labour Party have become born again Brexiteers. Yeah. The Labour Party is doing damage and will do damage to our economy because of their hard Brexit stance. And the only way Scotland escapes the born again Brexiteers, be they be Tories, be they be the Labour Party, is by having the full powers of an independent nation, presiding officer.
Question number three, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the First Minister for what reason consultants have reportedly been hired to advise on the next Clyde and Hebrides ferry contract.
First Minister.
We are committed to engaging with our various stakeholders in the development of the next generation of the Clyde and Hebrides ferry services contracts, including, of course, engaging with our island communities. As I said yesterday at the Convener's Committee, it's routine practice to use specialist advisers for complex, high-value projects such as this one to help ensure that we deliver a service that meets our needs and delivers value for money. Our external advisers will assist with commercial and programme management of the project. They'll provide a level of technical expertise to ensure the contract reflects industry best practice to deliver a service that meets both current and indeed future requirements. We'll also seek the views of communities and other stakeholders to inform the approach that's been taken.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, the problem is the Scottish Government has now spent £5.5 million on consultants to advise them on what to think about how to run the ferry network. We've had Project Neptune that set out a number of options. Then Angus Campbell was tasked with asking Islanders what they think, what's been the outcome of that. Now, the current contract with CalMac, which has already been extended, expires in 15 months' time. There's no time left to start the procurement process for the next time. The government's approach has been all dither, delay and incompetence.
Absolutely.
So, can the First Minister tell us if CalMac will be awarded another extension, and is he now considering a new operating model for how we run and procure ferries?
First Minister.
We know that the Tories for a long time have not liked the use of experts. That has been something that they've made clear over the years, but I do think it's so important that a contract on a project of this size does get in the technical expertise that is required. And look, I'll make no apologies at all for the fact that we are engaging with the island communities. And Graeme Simpson is absolutely right to mention that work being taken forward by Angus Campbell. That was, of course, a recommendation, a key recommendation of the Project Neptune report. So Angus Campbell has spent the past few months visiting, engaging with island communities, and ferry users, and that report should be with ministers very soon. And although there's no specific obligation to inform Parliament to procurement competitions, we will of course update Parliament in relation to decisions that are taken, because we understand just how important this matter is. What we are looking to do is of course ensure that island communities have the best possible service that they possibly can, and we are focused on making sure that the current service is as resilient and reliable as possible. That's why, of course, we made sure we chartered, or CalMac chartered, DMV Alfred. What I will also do, what I won't do, is preempt the outcome, of course, of the current work that's taking place. But what I can restate unequivocally is that we have no plans to privatise, nor indeed split up the Clyde and Hebrides ferry network.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The problem with the Clyde and Hebrides ferry service is not the contract, but it's the ferry fleet. And the First Minister knows the provision of the fleet is the responsibility of the Scottish Government. A consultant's report can't cover up their dismal failure to provide working ferries. Will he now apologise for his own and his government's failure to provide ferries that are up to the job?
First Minister.
We have invested in our ferry service, our ferry fleet. We're, of course, going to invest and continue to invest with six ferries to add to that fleet and to add to the resilience of that fleet. But in the meantime, we're not waiting for those ferries to be built. Where we can charter additional tonnage, we are doing so. And CalMac has spent a considerable amount of money, rightly so, in order to ensure that they have the MV Alfred in place, which is currently, of course, providing that additional resilience on the Arran route, a very important route for the islanders, of course, but very important to Scotland too.
Donald Cameron.
The island of Mull is currently at the sharp end of Scotland's ferry crisis, with many people simply unable to get on or off the island as a result of the SNP's catastrophic management of our ferry network. Residents are at their wits' end, especially with the alternative route via the Corran ferry being out of service. Island communities are rightly calling for a compensation scheme, so will the First Minister commit to this, and what urgent action will he take to sort out the problems currently being suffered by islanders on Mull?
First Minister.
Well, I'm sure that the Transport Minister communicates with Donald Cameron directly around the actions we're taking in relation to the issues that are facing the community on Mull. Of course, these issues around compensation have understandably and rightly been raised many a time with the government, and I have looked into the issue around those penalty deductions that are made in relation to failures on the network. My view is that we should continue to use that money to reinvest into the ferry network. I think there is a legitimate call around the use of those deductions, but I would say that I think the best use of that money is reinvesting back into the network. To give just one example, I've mentioned the MV Alfred already. It's been chartered at a cost of £9 million. About £1 to £3 million of that is coming from the performance deductions and those penalties that Donald Cameron mentioned. So I think it's right that money is reinvested for the benefit of the entire resilience of the network.
Question number four, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the role of social media in encouraging violence towards pupils and teachers in schools.
First Minister.
Violence is never acceptable. The safety of pupils and staff in our schools is of absolute paramount importance to the Government. I'm deeply concerned about the violent content involving bullying and violent attacks in schools and public transport and other places where young people gather that are being posted online. Westminster's Online Safety Bill could be a means to ensure social media companies take seriously their responsibility to contain violent content. I wrote to the UK Government on the 9th of May urging it to use the bill to tackle this very issue. We have produced guidance for local authorities and schools to promote positive relationships, to manage behaviours, including de-escalation of violent behaviour. And as the Education Secretary announced yesterday, in the coming weeks she will convene a summit focused on tackling violence in schools.
Rona Mackay.
Thank the First Minister for the answer. The widespread use of apps like TikTok and Instagram broadcast violence beyond playground walls and leave staff vulnerable in ways they haven't been before. But As you see, the Scottish Government is limited in its powers when it comes to online activity. Will the Scottish Government implore the UK Government to call on social media companies to improve their own standards and sanctions when it comes to removing material that promote violence?
First Minister.
Yes, and I'm happy to work as constructively as we possibly can with the UK Government on that matter. I think all of us in this chamber probably conclude rightly that online social media companies can do a lot more when it comes to violent content and when it comes to hateful content. Again, something I think members in this chamber have unfortunately been the subject of for many, many years. And while that regulatory responsibility for social media does lie with the UK Government, I'm very clear that providers do have a responsibility to enforce their own policies on harmful online content. We will also reflect on what more we can do, even though we don't have the regulatory powers to do so. We can maybe perhaps engage with social media companies at a ministerial level to see what more pressure we can apply so that, as I say, they live up to their own policies on harmful online content.
Stephen Kerr.
Yesterday, his government finally accepted the Scottish Conservatives' call for urgent action on violence and disruptive behaviour in schools. His Cabinet Secretary finally agreed that urgent action, not more talk, was needed to support Scotland's teachers and pupils. So will the First Minister make a commitment today that an action plan to tackle violence and disruption in schools will be in place for the start of the new school year in August?
First Minister.
Well, this, of course, is an important point and right for Stephen Kerr to raise. I do regret the fact that he's managed to turn this into, or try to attempt to turn this into, a political fight. I've said very clearly in my response, although the powers in relation to online content lie with UK Government, I'm willing to work constructively with them. And I think anybody here, whether you're a parent or not, frankly, can absolutely understand the hurt, the harm, the anxiety that's caused to young people and indeed staff, regardless of what our political persuasion is. So there is no hesitancy or reticence from the government to be as constructive, to be as proactive as we possibly can. And that's why, of course, the guidance that we've already issued on top of that, we provided £2 million of funding to support violence prevention activity within schools and communities. We're obviously, as Stephen Kerr, I should say, already knows, we're gathering evidence at the moment that will help us to better understand the extent of violence and behaviour at a national level, right through schools in Scotland. That started in February. I'll certainly reflect on what more we can do collectively before the school term starts.
Question number five, Claire Baker.
To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to reports of world-leading dementia expert Craig Ritchie leaving the NHS and his comments referring to problems with infrastructure and blockages in the system.
First Minister.
I am very grateful to all clinicians and researchers who make a valuable contribution to our NHS. I recognise very much the expertise Professor Ritchie has built up over his career. We share his ambition to improve interventions and support people with dementia, and I take his criticisms very seriously indeed. I've asked the Health Secretary to review and consider whether there's more that we need to do in these areas. Long waits to access dementia diagnosis and healthcare, they're not acceptable. That's why we allocated £6 million of ring-fence funding to dementia post-diagnostic support over the last 2 years. This is in addition to an estimated £2.2 billion that is spent on dementia across Scotland in 22-23 by local partnerships. That's a 14% increase since 2014. And we will publish our new dementia strategy just later this month, and a first two-year delivery plan will be agreed with partners and people with lived experience of dementia later this year.
Claire Baker.
I thank the First Minister for that response. I'm pleased that he's going to take Craig Ritchie's comments seriously, because the new delayed strategy will be the fourth iteration. But many of the commitments in the past 12 years have seen slow delivery or haven't been achieved. For example, post-diagnostic support. And contributions to the national conversation on the new strategy highlighted a gap between Scotland's commitment on dementia policy and people's experience of care. So can the First Minister advise how the new dementia strategy will address these persistent gaps between rhetoric and reality, alongside delivering any new commitments on the strategy? And he does say the related strategy delivery plan will be by the end of the year. Can he give that as a firm commitment, because we are still waiting on the original strategy, which is now late?
First Minister.
I will give a commitment, as I said, that we will publish our new dementia strategy later this month, and that first 2 year delivery plan will be agreed with partners and people with lived experience this year. I won't obviously preempt the strategy that's going to come out. I'm more than happy for the government to commit to ensuring there's a full discussion, even a debate, on that important strategy. I thought from Professor Ritchie's comments there was a number of issues that Claire Baker has rightly raised that I think we need to make sure we are making even more progress on, particularly in relation to research. And I'm pleased to be able to say that the Chief Scientist's Office has funded dementia and neuroprogressive network. Its pathway, over 1,000 people were recruited to dementia trials in 21-22. I want to see what more we can do in order to progress research in relation to dementia. And the second issue that I thought Professor Ritchie was absolutely right to raise, and again Claire Baker right to challenge the government on, is on diagnosis rates as well. So I've asked the Health Secretary to look at what more can be done to ensure that we have the data to hand to improve diagnosis rates as early as we possibly can for people with dementia.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Following the sequence of answers to Claire Baker, can I refer to the review that the First Minister raised? Can I ask it addresses the comments by the Professor that there are tests which can detect amyloid, a major contributor to dementia, and drugs which can clear this, but that government infrastructure is not in place to deliver either of these?
First Minister.
Yes, of course, that is one of the key comments that was made by Professor Ritchie again, which we will absolutely look at. And that's where the research side of things, of course, is so important. But on top of that, we're also quite keen to see what we can do in relation to increase the availability of medicines. We know there's not a drug that can cure dementia, unfortunately, and we hope that science will continue to make progress in relation to the fight against dementia, but where there are effective treatments or treatments that can be trialled, I'm really hopeful that there's more that we can do within our infrastructure to make them as widely as available as they possibly can be.
Question number 6, Ross Greer.
Thank you. To ask the First Minister what impact the Scottish Government's Nature Restoration Fund is having for communities on Arran.
First Minister.
Sure. The Nature Restoration Fund will provide £65 million over the course of this Parliament to multi-year, multi-partner projects to restore and regenerate nature and address climate change. To date, a total of £430,000 from the Fund's competitive scheme have been awarded to 3 projects on Arran: the Glen Habitat Restoration Project, the Dougherty Estates Green Network Project, and the support for the Coast Marine Restoration Project, all of which will bring benefits for both nature and local communities. North Ayrshire Council have also been directly allocated £356,000 since the Fund's inception. We'll shortly be writing to local authorities confirming their allocations for 23-24. Local authorities, of course, make decisions about local biodiversity priorities in relation to this funding.
Ross Greer.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. Last Friday, I had the privilege of attending the launch of the RV Coast Explorer at Lumlash Bay, and I'm proud that that vessel was partly funded by £200,000 from the Nature Restoration Fund established by the Scottish Greens. Lumlash Bay's no-take zone, which was demanded and delivered by the local community, has had astounding success. It's a brilliant example of highly protecting marine area. It's seen a huge recovery in the marine environment, which is great for nature and marine tourism, and it's boosted the local fishing industry. Species like scallop and lobster in adjacent waters are now bigger and more plentiful. So can I ask the First Minister how the sustained success of Lumlash Bay's no-take zone will be taken on board in progressing HPMAs elsewhere?
First Minister.
I absolutely agree with Ross Greer. Lumlash Bay is a perfect example of exactly what we're looking to achieve throughout Scotland's seas, an engaged local community reaping the benefits from that increased marine protection. Some of those benefits are very well articulated by Ross Greer. And it's great to see funding to Coast, the community of Arran Seabed Trust, from the Nature Restoration Fund which has helped to support the purchase of the MV Coast Explorer. So there are lots of lessons for us to learn. Of course, we've had many a discussion and a debate in this chamber, and I suspect we'll have many more on the issue of highly protected marine areas. But I've made it very, very clear we want to engage with communities, and the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and the Just Transition, amongst others, will travel right across our island communities, our coastal communities, to engage with those individuals that could be affected by highly protected marine areas. And let's get to a place where the communities that want to see that further protection in their marine environment, that we are working with them to ensure marine sustainability for the future.
Thank you. We're going to move to constituency and general supplementaries. I have several requests. I'm keen to get through them. I'd be grateful for concise questions and responses. And I call Colette Stevenson.
Presiding Officer, the latest ONS figures show inflation has dipped slightly to 8.7%. But food prices continue accelerating at the fastest pace for 45 years. The UK cost of living crisis has been years in the making, with Tory austerity, welfare reforms and Brexit hammering household incomes. Can the First Minister confirm what the Scottish Government is doing within the limited powers and resources it has to shield people from the harm created in large part by the actions of the Tories in Westminster?
First Minister.
It is almost a weekly occurrence, Presiding Officer, that whenever poverty is mentioned, we hear groans from the Conservative benches. The cost of living is still far too high for too many families who are already struggling, of course, with the increasingly unaffordable cost of food. The increase in housing, the increase of bills, energy bills, for example, and everyday essentials, after years and years of austerity, of a hard Brexit that's been imposed upon Scotland, and of course a complete and utter catastrophic economic mismanagement by the Tory government in London. So we will do everything we can within our powers, for example, delivering that game-changing Scottish child payment, tripling our fuel and security fund, providing free childcare to all 3- and 4-year-olds and eligible 2-year-olds, free bus travel to 2 million people. However, we know it's only with the full economic and fiscal powers of an independent nation can ministers use all the levers that other governments have to tackle inequalities. And just to give you one example, Presiding Officer, just the reversal of just a few of those regressive welfare decisions the UK government have made, if they just reversed a few of them, we could lift 70,000 people, including 30,000 children, out of poverty. No doubt about it, Presiding Officer, this cost of living crisis that have plunged so many people into poverty is a political choice by the Conservative Party, and the only way out of it is by achieving our independence.
Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mum of two, Jill Barclay, was beaten and raped by a stranger. Rhys Bennett then set her on fire while she was still alive. The judge described the 23-year-old's crimes as medieval in their barbarity. Yet his prison sentence was reduced due to new under-25 sentencing guidelines. So, can Humza Yousaf tell the people of Scotland whether he thinks these should apply in every single case, no matter how wicked or barbaric the crime?
First Minister.
Can I say to Russell Findlay, of course, these are not matters that are decisions for the First Minister. They are rightly left to the independent judiciary. And they must always be thus, even in the most heinous, despicable cases, such as the case of Jill Barclay that has just been referenced by Russell Findlay. And of course, I think all of our thoughts will be with Jill, the family affected by what was a despicable crime. And of course, her family will undoubtedly, her community, her friends, be reeling from the barbarity of that sickening and medieval act as described by Russell Findlay. But it can never be the case that politicians, let alone government ministers, interfere in decisions that are made, sentencing decisions that are made by the judiciary. And of course, sentencing guidelines are taken forward again by the Independent Sentencing Council. What I have said in relation to a previous case that has been raised with me as First Minister is that the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, in her regular engagement with the Sentencing Council, has asked for more information around when those regular reviews of sentencing guidance will take place. And of course, I'm sure she'll be happy to keep the member informed of those discussions.
Michael Marrow.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a letter received by my constituent in July 2022 from this SNP government. It told her that surgery for lower pelvic prolapse should be completed within 1 year by order of Cabinet Secretary for Health, Humza Yousaf. My constituent has now waited for her surgery for 8.5 years. As a last resort, we spoke to the press about this deeply personal situation. That forced the hand of NHS Tayside, who will now pay for the private surgery. Why should it come to this, First Minister? 8.5 years, telling the most intimate details of your life to journalists. These were your guarantees. I now have two further cases of women in Tayside waiting years and years for this essential surgery. So how many women are waiting for treatment for lower pelvic prolapse, and for how long? Does he know? Is this another Tayside crisis, or are women across Scotland suffering in silence?
First Minister.
Can I thank Michael Manna for raising what is an incredibly important issue, and the issue of lower pelvic prolapse, of course, affects many women right up and down the country. There's no doubt, of course, that we, of course, had challenges around our waiting times pre the pandemic, but I don't think there's any doubt by any objective measure that, of course, the pandemic, which has been the biggest shock our NHS has ever faced in its almost 75-year existence, has undoubtedly had a significant impact. We are focused on trying to help and assist those that have been waiting the longest. So our focus has been on those two-year waits. And the number of outpatients, for example, that have been waiting over 2 years, they've declined and dropped and reduced by over 50% since September, by over 60% since June last year. In terms of inpatients, as well, the numbers waiting over 2 years for inpatient day cases was down 28% in 6 months. In fact, 18 out of 30 specialities had fewer than 10 patients waiting more than 2 years. So we are making progress. In terms of the cases, the specific cases that Michael Marra has, I'm more than happy that he forwards them either to myself or indeed to the Cabinet Secretary for Health. And anything that we can do to assist, of course, we will seek to do.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister will be aware of the latest update from the Competition and Markets Authority indicating that global factors are not solely to blame for high fuel prices, with the evidence indicating that fuel margins have increased across the retail market over the past 4 years, but particularly for supermarkets. The First Minister will also be aware that I've raised this issue in the Chamber before with regards to Morrison's, Tesco and BP ripping off my Greenock and Inverclyde constituents. Will the First Minister commit the Scottish Government to making representations to the UK Government and also to the CMA when the full report is published in July to ensure that reforms are forthcoming to prevent fuel retailers from robbing my constituents?
First Minister.
I will make representations as Stuart McMillan has asked me to do, and can I also commend Stuart McMillan for raising this issue consistently in this chamber on behalf of his constituents. There's simply no doubt that high fuel prices have contributed to the cost of living crisis for people and indeed for businesses right across Scotland. The Scottish Government has raised inconsistent pricing in between, for example, urban and rural areas, but in particular areas such as Inverclyde, and we've raised those issues with the Competition and Markets Authority as a key issue for investigation, but I'm happy to re-emphasise those points to the CMA. As such, I do welcome the latest update from the CMA and note that as well as seeking more information from supermarkets on their role in the fuel market, they've indicated that their final report will cover that important issue of geographic variation in pricing. And as I say, I will make sure that if there's any further representations we can make, we will make them on this issue.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I met with the Chief Superintendent of Lanarkshire Police earlier this week, and of the many things we discussed around the increasing pressure on the police force, the fact that over 15,000 cases they attended last month, only 19% involved criminal activity was a bit of a surprise. Much of the rest of those cases were around mental health issues. I wanted to ask the First Minister if there's a recognition that cutting much of the other support services is putting an increased pressure on police time, especially at a time when they're having to cut the numbers in the streets.
Yeah. First Minister.
Can I say we've, over the years, increased our spend on mental health quite considerably, actually, from this government. And in relation to particularly young people, we are ensuring that we are increasing the number of staff that we have that work in CAMHS and in psychological services. Notwithstanding that, Brian Whittle is absolutely right to raise the issue of the amount of police time that is taken in relation to helping those with mental health challenges and vulnerabilities. Now, that is not great for the police and the police service. It's also, of course, not the best for the individual that is suffering from those mental health challenges too. So there's a range of work that we've done through the distress brief intervention, for example, the enhanced mental health pathway, and I'm happy to write to Brian Whittle, or I'm sure the Health Secretary writes to Brian Whittle with the detail, the various interventions that we have underway, but he can be absolutely assured the Cabinet Secretary for Health and indeed the Cabinet Secretary for Justice are working closely on this matter.
And Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over a period of 30 years, hundreds, maybe even thousands of little girls sent by the state to Ferneithy House Residential School for care, for nurturing, were instead subjected to a catalogue of unimaginable mental, physical and in some cases sexual abuse. To date, none of the perpetrators of this abuse have been fully brought to justice. Dozens of those little girls, now women, are in Parliament today to listen to my members' debate on justice for the Ferneithy survivors. Whilst they do not expect the First Minister to intervene in a police investigation, they do want to be listened to. So they've asked me to ask you, First Minister, if you'll personally meet with them, not necessarily today but soon, listen to their plight and give them that unequivocal assurance that what happened to those little girls will be properly acknowledged. That is surely the least we can do.
First Minister.
Yes, I will commit to meeting with the survivors, and I have met with some of the survivors. Some of them are constituents of mine. I've met them in a local MSP capacity. I'm afraid I won't be able to do it today, but I'm certain our offices will liaise to be able to find a suitable time. I, of course, commend Colin Smith for bringing the members' debate. I know that will be taking place after this. Again, I hope you'll accept my apologies that I will not be able to stay for that, but I know the Deputy First Minister will respond on behalf of the government. But in terms of his request, he's absolutely right. I think it is the least we can do, that I can do, and I'd be happy to meet with the survivors and would invite Colin Smith, of course, to assist us in facilitating that meeting.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. The next item of business is a member's business debate in the name of Colin Smith. There will be a short suspension to allow those leaving the chamber and public gallery to do so.